Today I will deliver a lecture on profile of Indian tribes. The tribal population is found in almost all parts of the world. India has the largest concentration of tribal population. Total population of scheduled tribes is 8 crores 43 lakhs 26,000 240 as per the census 2001, which accounts for 8.2% of the total population of the country. The tribals are believed to be the earliest settlers in Indian peninsula. They are generally called the Adivasis, implying original inhabitants. A tribe is a homogeneous and self-contained unit without any hierarchical discrimination. In this unit, an outline of the Indian tribes, particularly their geographical classification, linguistic classification, racial, economic, and cultural divisions will be given. The tribes of India live in the forest hills and naturally isolated regions known as a rule by different names, meaning either the people of forest and hill or the original inhabitants, and so on. The popular names are Vanya Jati, that is castes of forest, Vanvasi, inhabitants of forest, Pahari, hill dwellers, Adivasi, first settlers, Janjati, folk people, Adinjati, primitive people, Anusuchit Janjati, scheduled tribe, and so on. Among all these tribes, the term Adivasi is the most popular term. Anusuchit Janjati, that is scheduled tribe, is the constitutional name covering all of them. We will begin with the geographical distribution of the tribes. The tribes of India, on the basis of geography of India and tribal demography, can be classified regionally. Guha, in between 1951 and 1955, demarcated 3 tribal zones. They are Northern and Northeastern area, the Central Belt, and the Peninsular India. Majumdar and Madan in 1956 also refer to these zones and present a somewhat similar distribution. They have called them Northern and Northeastern zone, the Central or Middle zone, and the Southern zone. Dubé in 1960 has classified the geographical regions of the tribals into 4 zones: the North and Northeastern zone, the Middle zone, the South zone, and the West zone. Again, in 1971, Roy Berman divided the tribal communities living in different regions into 5 territorial groups. Taking into consideration the geographical, ecological, and social, economic, administrative, ethnic, and even racial factors, Vidyarthi and Rai in 1976 proposed a 4-fold geographical region along with one distinct sub-region of the islands. These are Himalayan region with 3 sub-regions, namely Northeastern Himalayan region, which consists of Assam, Meghalaya, mountainous region of West Bengal, that is Darjeeling, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram, and Tripura. Central Himalayan region. The Tarai areas of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar fall in this group. Northwestern Himalayan region. Himachal Pradesh and Jammu and Kashmir constitute this region. Middle India region, which comprises Bihar, West Bengal, Orissa, and Madhya Pradesh. Western India region, including Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, and Dadra and Nagar Haveli. South India region. It comprises Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Kerala with a meager tribal population. The island region, The islands of Andaman and Nicobar in the Bay of Bengal and Lakshadweep in the Arabian Sea constitute a distinct sub-region. Now we come to the linguistic classification. The linguistic map of India and the languages found among the tribals indicate that the Dravidian linguistic family is found in the Dravidian region in South India and a few pockets in Middle India in Chota Nagpur and northwestern border. Another linguistic family, Austroasiatic, is found in certain pockets in the northeastern Himalayan region. Tibeto-Chinese is the third language, which is traced on the map and is prevalent all along the Himalayan region. The Indo-European language is found in the remaining parts of India. All these suggest a linguistic drift from northwestern to southern India and again in the pockets of middle India in the case of Dravidian languages. There is much controversy regarding the origin of the Austroasiatic language. Tibeto-Chinese family is again subdivided into Siamese-Chinese subfamily. It includes the Tai group, that is Khamti, Fakial, etc. Tibeto-Burman subfamily, which is again subdivided into four groups. Tibeto-Himalayan branch, that is the Bhotias of Darjeeling. Western subgroup or pro-nominalized Himalayan group, that is Chamba, Lahauli, Swangli, Kanauri, etc. Non-pro-nominalized Himalayan group, which includes the Rong or Lepcha, Toto, etc. Arunachal branch, which includes the Akha, Abot, Miri, Dafla, Mishmi, etc. Assam Burmese branch, divided into Boro group, which includes Plains Kacharis, Dimasa or Hill Kachari, Garo, etc. Naga group, including Angami, Ao, Sema, Rengma, Kabui, etc. Kachin group, including the Singpho, and Kukichin group, comprising Mar, Kuki, Thado, Paite, Lushai, etc. Dravidian family, consisting of Dravidian group, like Korawa, Yerukala, Yarava, Badaga, Toda, Kota, etc. Indo-European family, including Hajong, Bhili, etc. Now, what is the racial classification of the Indian tribes? Guha, Hatton, and Majumdar attempted to provide racial classifications of the Indian people. Guha's classification of 1935 is the most accepted classification. He lists six main races with nine subtypes of Indian population. They are Negrito, the Proto-Australoid, the Mongoloid, again subdivided into Paleo-Mongoloids and Tibeto-Mongoloids, the Mediterranean, subdivided into Paleo-Mediterranean, Mediterranean and Oriental type, the Western Brachycephals, subdivided into Alpinoid, Dinaric and Armenoid, and lastly the Nordic. As regards the racial composition of tribes of India, Guha in 1952 has concluded that the Kadars, the Irulas and the Panyans of South India with frizzly hair have undoubted Negro strain. The tribes of Middle India belong to the Proto-Australoid stock. The brachycephalic Mongoloids of northeastern India have typical features of the face and the eye. A slightly different Mongoloid type with medium stature, high head and medium nose lives in the Brahmaputra Valley. The tribes form an integral part of the Indian population. Their socio-economic life, religious beliefs are distinct, and their association with the Hindu neighbors for a long time has all given a definitive character to their lives. Various authorities are trying to find out the level of integration with the rest of the Indian people and their culture. Majumdar, in 1947, classified them into three groups. Primitive tribes outside the Hindu influence. Primitive tribes which have adopted Hindu customs, beliefs and practices, though they are not recognized as forming prominent castes. Primitive tribes who are Hinduized but maintain social distance from the clean castes. In the above classification, Hinduism is regarded as an important agent of change so far as tribal culture is concerned. Majumdar again gives a general classification and agreed that there is hardly any tribal community who is not in contact with the rest of the Indian population. They are the assimilated, adaptive, that is the so-called transitional culture, commensalic, common economic pursuits with neighbors, symbiotic, interdependence, and acculturative, that is one-way traffic of cultural traits. Elwin in 1943 gave a fourfold classification on the basis of external influence on tribal life. Those who are most primitive live a joint communal life and cultivate with excess. Those who, though equally attached to their solitude and ancient traditions, are more individualistic, less occupied with excultivation, more used to outside life, and generally less simple than the first group. Then there are those who are the most numerous, probably 20 million, and are under external influence and are already on the way to lose their tribal culture, religion and social organization. The fourth group includes tribes like the Bhil and the Naga, which retain much of their original tribal life and free of culture contact. Dubey in 1960 also proposed a more or less similar classification like Elwin. The Tribal Welfare Committee, constituted by the Indian Conference of Social Work in 1952, divided the tribes of India into four main divisions: tribal communities, semi-tribal communities, acculturated tribal communities, and totally assimilated tribes. After going through the above classifications and taking into consideration the factors of Hinduization, external influence, culture contact, neighborhood, welfare, etc., Vidyarthi and Rai in 1976 have assessed the level of integration of the tribes of India as follows. Distinct tribal communities living in highly isolated regions, example, the forest hunting tribes and the hill cultivators. Rural tribals who are living in rural areas and are dependent on agriculture and other allied occupations, example, agriculturist tribes. Semi-acculturated tribals who have successfully blended their own cultural traditions with the neighboring people and the situation, example, the tribal communities living in mixed villages. Acculturated tribals who have adopted modern occupations in urban and industrial fields and have mixed to a great extent with the rest of the population, example, industrial laborers. Totally assimilated tribals who have acquired a place in the Hindu caste ladder, example, the Bhumis, the Majis, the Khasas, the Rajgons, etc. Now we come to the economic classification. The tribes of India have been broadly classified into eight groups on the basis of their primary occupations. They are as follows. Forest hunting type. The Birhors, hill kharias of Middle India belong to this group. Hill cultivation type. Examples, the Aonagas, Rengma Nagas of Nagaland and Purums of Manipur. Settled agricultural type. Examples: Mundas, Hos and Santhals of Middle India. Simple artisan type. Example: the Gujjars of Kashmir, Kanjars of Uttar Pradesh, etc. Cattle herder type. Example: Todas of Nilgiri, Kurubas of Mysore. Labor, agricultural and industrial type. Example: tribes of Bihar, Orissa, Bengal, etc. Folk artist type. The Nats and Saperas of southeastern Uttar Pradesh belong to this category. White collar jobs and trader type. Bhutias of Almora and Garhwal of Uttar Pradesh belong to this 8th category. The tribes of different parts of India are passing through an accelerated phase of transformation and have greatly disturbed the equilibrium in the traditional society. As a result of their long and continuous contacts with the regional Hindu castes, many tribal groups have long been assimilated as castes in the regional caste hierarchy. Numerous other tribes have undergone selective acculturation and have added selected traits or features of the regional Hindu castes. In this process, they have failed to occupy any rank in the caste hierarchy. The spread of Christianity through the Western missionaries succeeded in bringing about a marked change in the sacred, social, educational, and economic status of the converted tribal groups. In recent years, urbanization and industrialization have brought about revolutionary changes in some parts of tribal India. These have led to the development of communications within the tribal areas and with the outside world, introduced monetized economy, spread formal and modern education, led to the extension of facilities like medical and administrative aids, and introduction of advanced technology to exploit the mineral, forest, power, and other industrial resources. But the rate of change evidently differs among different types of the tribes. Moreover, they have retained the traditional elements of their ways of life, though these are modified to a greater or lesser extent.